Today we're reading the epilogue of The Watsons Go to Birmingham, 1963, by Christopher Paul Curtis. Epilogue. At the time of the Watson family's trip, the U.S. South was caught up in a struggle for basic human rights that became known as the Civil Rights Movement. Although the Declaration of Independence states that all men are created equal, and the Constitution had been amended after the Civil War to extend the rights and protections of citizenship to African Americans, changing the law of the land did not always change the way people behaved. In the northern, eastern, and western states, African Americans often faced discrimination, but it was not as extreme and pervasive as in the South. There, communities and states passed laws that allowed discrimination in schooling, housing, and job opportunities, prohibited interracial marriages, and enforced segregation by creating separate facilities for African Americans and whites. In most of the South, African Americans were not permitted to attend the same schools as whites or to use the same parks, playgrounds, swimming pools, hospitals, drinking fountains, or bathrooms. Hotels, restaurants, and stores would not serve African Americans. The worst sections of public facilities were set aside for coloreds only. White children often attended large, well-equipped modern schools, while African-American students went to one-room schoolhouses without enough books or teachers. Rigged laws and tests prevented African-Americans from voting. A number of organizations and individuals were working tirelessly to end segregation and discrimination. The National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, the NAACP, the Congress of Racial Equality, CORE, and Southern Christian Leadership Conference, SCLC, as well as Thurgood Marshall, John Lewis, Ralph Abernathy, Medgar Evers, Fannie Lou Hamer, and Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., along with many other people whose names have been forgotten, these men and women strove to change the laws through nonviolent resistance. They adopted many of the techniques that Mohandas Gandhi had used to liberate India from British rule. Sit-ins and boycotts of stores and public transportation applied economic pressure. Freedom riders, African Americans and whites, took bus trips throughout the South to test federal laws that banned segregation in interstate transportation. Black students had enrolled in segregated schools such as Central High in Little Rock, Arkansas, and the University of Alabama. Picketing, protest marches, and demonstrations made headlines. Civil rights workers carried out programs for voter education and registration. The goal was to create tension and provoke confrontations that would force the federal government to step in and enforce the laws. Often, the tension exploded into gunshots, fires, and bombings directed against the people who so bravely fought for change. The characters and events in this novel are fictional. However, there were many unsolved bombings in Birmingham at the time of the story, including the one that took place at the 16th Street Baptist Church on September 15, 1963. Four young teenage girls, Addie Mae Collins, Denise McNair, Carol Robertson, and Cynthia Wesley, were killed when a bomb went off during Sunday school. Addie Mae Collins' sister, Sarah, had to have an eye removed, and another girl was blinded. In the unrest that followed the bombing, two other African-American children died. 16-year-old Johnny Robinson was shot to death by police, and 13-year-old Virgil Wade was murdered by two white boys. Although these may be nothing more than names in a book to you now, you must remember that these children were just as precious to their families as Joetta was to the Watsons, or as your brothers and sisters are to you. Despite the danger, the civil rights movement grew stronger, gaining support all over the country. On August 28, 1963, 200,000 people marched on Washington, D.C. to pressure Congress to pass the Civil Rights Bill and heard Martin Luther King Jr. deliver his unforgettable I Have a Dream speech. President Lyndon Johnson signed the Civil Rights Bill on July 2, 1964, and signed the Voting Rights Act on August 6, 1965. In 1968, Congress passed the Fair Housing Act. The individuals who supported the civil rights movement took great risks to force America to change. It was a people's movement inspired by the courageous acts of ordinary citizens like Rosa Parks, the seamstress from Montgomery, Alabama, who began the first great effort of the movement, the Montgomery bus boycott of 1955 and 56, when she refused to give up her seat to a white man. Many heroic people died in the struggle for civil rights. Many others were injured or arrested or lost their homes or businesses. It is almost impossible to imagine the courage of the first African-American children who walked into segregated schools, or the strength of the parents who permitted them to face the hatred and violence that awaited them. They did it in the name of the movement, in the quest for freedom. These people are true American heroes. They are the boys and girls, the women and men, who have seen that things are wrong and have not been afraid to ask, "Why can't we change this?" They are the people who believe that as long as one person is being treated unfairly, we all are. These are our heroes, and they still walk among us today. One of them may be sitting next to you as you read this, or standing in the next room making your dinner, or waiting for you to come outside and play. One of them may be you.